everyone. Welcome you for another AY program this evening. We wish you each one a happy Sabbath. To begin our song service this evening, let us sing, "I Just Keep Trusting My Lord."
Thank you. Sabbath. Proverbs chapter 3 verses 5 and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lead not unto your own understanding. Acknowledge him and he will direct your path." With this verse in mind, I would like to welcome you all today for the AY service. To begin, let's all sing, "I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart," as the opening song. Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, I thank you so much for being there with us. Thank you for keeping us safe and sound, and thank you for the Sabbath day that you have given to us. As we enter into the holy hours, bless us and also bless the program that has been prepared for us. Continue to be there with all of them, and also I pray that whatever we do, help it bring praise and honor to you. Forgive our sins and shortcomings, for we all submit ourselves into your care and keeping. For I ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening and a very happy Sabbath to each one of you. Once again, thank you for joining us for another AY service. I pray that each of you would be blessed by the program that is prepared for you. Many people have told me that I ask a lot of questions. Some say that I'm too curious or that I get too deep. A few of them said that talking to me is like talking to a lawyer. Some even suggested that I join the police department or something of that sort. I don't know. However, that got me thinking. I ask a lot of questions to people that I see every day, even though I know that they don't have all the answers. So just imagine how many questions I would have for someone that I've never seen, the one who has all the answers. A very close friend once told me that the thing that she's looking forward to the most about heaven is that all her questions would be answered, and that she'd finally understand why things happen the way they did. We know that all our questions would be answered one day, but what about now? There are so many questions that cross our mind every single day. With everything that's happening around us, we raise our heads toward heaven and say, "Why, God? Why?" There are certain questions that God has answered through His Word, the Bible, the Spirit of prophecy, or through the knowledge that He imparts to the people around us. But what about the questions that are unanswerable? That's what today's AY program is about. If you could ask God one question, what would it be?
How could a perfect being sin if there was no one to tempt him?
If I could ask one question to God, I would ask him, "Dear Lord, how and why do you love me so much?"
God, when are you going to come to take us home?
If God knows every single person's future, why would he still strive with those people he knew exactly are going to be lost?
I think I would ask God, what's my purpose in life?
If I could ask God one question, then that would be the secret to forgive and be patient in all situations, no matter what.
If I could ask God one question, I would ask him more ways to make my parents happy.
If I could ask one question to God, definitely would be, "Where are you, Lord? When are things gonna get better?"
If I could ask God one question, that would be, "Why did all-knowing God create Lucifer if he knew he's going to become Satan one day?"
What if God could undo the act of sin at the garden itself?
Give us shelter in the storms of life, and there's no peace on earth, there's peace in Christ.
Why does God delaying us answering sincere prayers when we desperately need them?
I would ask God what exactly he felt when he saw his son dying on the cross for all of us.
One thing I would like to ask to God is, when all this suffering will end? When?
The question I would ask God is, why me, Lord?
Hello everyone. While I may have many questions to ask God, the one that stands out to me right now is, why do bad things happen to good people and vice versa?
And we have learned this over a period of time, that this is the way the pandemic is behaving, and therefore the decisions that are taken in terms of our people.
I have a question here. Oh Lord, my God, when will you come?
We'll be at home beyond the blue sky.
very happy Sabbath to everyone. I'm sure everyone has a question that we would like to ask God when we see Him face to face. Well, what if you have that opportunity now? What would your questions be? I'm sure you have thought about it. I'm sure you have lots of questions that you would like to ask. But, you know, by now you must have realized that we have a lot more questions than answers, you know, in our lives. And there are a lot of questions which only God can answer. Now, talking about questions. Now, if you have a toddler at home, I do, you know what happens. What's the most common question that a toddler would ask? Well, I know, because the question is, why? A toddler asks this question a lot of times. And they ask the question, why this, why that? And then when you give an explanation, you know what follows? But why? A why followed by another why. Well, here's an example. A few days ago, I was behind my house with my daughter, the younger one, and we saw a grasshopper. So she asked me, Daddy, what is that? And I said, that's a grasshopper. It was the next question that she came up with. But why? It's not, she didn't come back and say, oh, that is a grasshopper. No, she didn't say that. You know what she said? But why? But why? Are you asking me, but why is that a grasshopper? Well, anyway, here's an interesting fact about toddlers. You know, they say a toddler asks the question, why, 70 million times in a day. That's a fact. 70 million times in a day they ask, why this, why that? No, no, that's not a fact, that's not true. That's not true because, but, you know, you being with a toddler the whole day under this lockdown, it feels like it's 70 million times the question was asked to you. I'm sure a lot of parents can agree with me on that, and a lot of older siblings who are with toddlers. Now, this evening, we're going to ask, or explore rather, some of the questions that we may have. In fact, I will touch upon two most commonly asked questions to God. Why, God? Why this? Okay. The two questions that we will be discussing are why the suffering? Okay, why the suffering, and why are some of our answers, some of our prayers being not answered? Now, if we take a look at the Bible, there's a very common verse that we, most of us must have memorized this by now. Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. It says, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. Now comes the whys. Okay, why? Let's ask this question. Have you ever come across, you know, times in life where you have asked and not received? You have searched and you have not found. You have knocked and yet it wasn't open. Then why did Jesus make this promise? Why did He promise that if you ask, it will be given to you? If you seek, you will find it. If you knock, it will be open unto you. Why did Jesus make this promise? And why do we feel that this promise is being not fulfilled? When you asked and, you know, searched and knocked, when you did that, what was your faith like? Did you believe that God will provide the answer? Did you really believe that you're going to get the answer? Or did you just pray for the sake of praying? And how many times have you asked God for that to be answered? Have you fasted and prayed about it? Have you earnestly prayed for the answers to God? What was your intention when you asked this to God? Was it a good intention? Well, obviously, everyone prayed for the good of everyone. Well, I'm sure a lot of times we come back disappointed because we feel that our questions, our prayers are not being answered by God. Why do we have that feeling? Why do we feel that our prayers and questions are not being answered? Maybe there's something that we do not factor in. That is God's intentions. Maybe we never thought of what God's intentions might be when you ask for certain things. So let's take a look at a couple of questions. The first question that we look into is, why do bad things happen to good people and vice versa? I'm sure this question is asked a lot by many of us. Why me? Why am I suffering? Why is that person suffering? He's a good man, she's a good lady. Why do they suffer? And why not the bad guys? The bad guys should be the ones suffering. And yet, it seems to us that the bad guys are the ones who are getting scot-free. And the good ones are the ones who are suffering. Why do we have that feeling? Let's take a look and see. Let's explore and see. Now, here's the answer. It says, when you have an explanation, pain doesn't seem so bad anymore. We can tolerate suffering when we know why it is happening. Okay? Now, imagine you're in a hospital. You're in a hospital and you hear a woman screaming. Screaming at the top of her lungs, suffering. Okay? And yet, here you see her relatives, the woman's relatives, chit-chatting and smiling. And they don't seem that bothered by the screaming and the shouting of this lady. And then you ask, why are you all so inconsiderate? You know, and why are you all just chit-chatting? Why aren't you concerned about this lady? And their answer was, well, this is a delivery ward. She's having a baby. Of course, we are happy. So if we know the reason why, if we have an explanation as to why people suffer, we can tolerate the suffering a lot more better. Now let's look at the Bible and see some of the reasons why God permits suffering in our lives. God does have reasons, even if we dislike or do not understand them. Now, suffering can be due to the fallen state of creation, and that we can find in Romans chapter 8, verses 19 and 22. So suffering, number one, can be due to the fallen state of creation. We know from the time when our fathers, Adam and Eve, when they sinned, that's where suffering began. Now, suffering can be a punishment for sin. Well, sometimes, not always, but let's take a look at the book of Judges. If you open the book of Judges, chapter 2, verses 11 and 15, it tells you that the suffering is caused because of the punishment for sin. And yet, it may not always be because of the punishment of sin, because in the book of John, chapter 9, verses 1 to 3, it says, it talks about a blind man and his disciples, the disciples of Jesus asked, who sinned, who had sinned that this man is suffering? So it may not be sin always, or it may not be that case. Now, God can permit Satan to inflict suffering, and that is very, very clear. If we look at the story of Job, in the book of Job, chapter 1 and chapter 2, you can see Job suffering. Why? Because God permitted Satan to inflict the suffering. And we suffer, or humans suffer, because it displays God's justice. Again, Romans 9, verses 19 to 26 tells us that it can display God's justice. Now, suffering can also drive sinners to repentance. The psalmist wrote in the book of Psalms, chapter 119, verse 71. It says, it is because of sin that we're suffering, and because of the suffering, a sinner can be driven to repentance. It can also be used to advance God's kingdom. So suffering is also cause so that God's kingdom can be advanced. That is evident in the book of Peter, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 and 19. Verse 12 to 19. And also it is to sanctify us. That can be found in Romans 5, 3 to 5, and also in James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. Well, indeed, the most stunning instance of a bad thing happening to a good person can be found in the life of Jesus, in the life and death of Jesus. The death of Jesus accomplished the good of salvation. But sometimes when facing the most gratuitous and inexplicable of evils, we can but trust God. Trust that God's ways are beyond our own. So sometimes we may not understand a lot of things, because a lot of God's ways are mysterious to human beings. So all we have to do is trust Him that whatever is happening for the good. So that is a question about suffering. Why do we suffer? Now, the next question that we can look at is, why does God delay in answering sincere prayers when we desperately need them? Well, very simple. Here are a few points. Why does God delay in answering sincere prayers when we desperately need them? Well, number one, sin in our lives. It's because of the sins in our lives that sometimes our prayers have been delayed by God. So what do? We have to confess and repent. Now, the psalmist wrote, if I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Psalm 66, 18. Not that God is unable to hear, because He is omniscient, but that He maintains His distance when we allow sin to be a wall between us and God. Now, sometimes God answers our prayers with a no, because a yes could bring harm to us. And sometimes our prayers have been delayed because God has something far greater in store for us. Now, we pray for things that are already determined. For example, you know, praying for a boy when it has already been determined that it is going to be a girl. We get discouraged in prayer by thinking that God has said no, when in fact He said nothing at all. Wait is an answer. It's not God not answering you. It is God answering by saying wait, because delay is not denial. God often delays His answers to cultivate patience and persistence and build our faith, or to bring our will around to conform to His own will. Now, God's no is not a rejection, but it says it is a redirection. So God's no is not a rejection, it is a redirection. Because if we look at the book of Samuel, in the story of David, King David, 2 Samuel chapter 7, God said no to David's desire to rebuild the temple. God said no. It was just a redirection so that his son Solomon could build it. God's no is not a punishment. It is a preparation. So why do we feel there is a delay in answering our sincere prayer? Well, because it is not a punishment. It is a preparation. A preparation for what? Romans chapter 5 verses 2 to 5, it says, well, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. So why does God delay in answering sincere prayers when we desperately need them? Well, because of these reasons. Because a lot of times we do not understand God's ways. And what do we do in those circumstances? We just have to wait and trust that God knows what's best for each one of us. And I'm sure you have a lot of other questions that you need answered. And a lot of questions may not be found in the Bible. So what do we do in those circumstances? Well, all you have to do is pray earnestly that one day you're going to be face to face with God and asking your questions to Him, and you're going to get the answer directly from Him. Pray and hope that that day comes to each one of us. And happy Sabbath once again to everyone.
Too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see his plan, when you can't trace his hand, trust his heart. He alone is faithful and true. He alone knows what is best for you.
In closing, we have a few announcements. The first announcement is about tomorrow's Sabbath School program beginning at 10 a.m. It's entitled, My Father is Like the Father. The second announcement is for the little children. We will be beginning Story Hour Tuesdays at 7 p.m. beginning from this week, June 23rd, 7 p.m. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Almighty Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you for blessing us with another Sabbath evening. I pray that you be with us through these Sabbath hours. Thank you for taking care of us day in and day out and during this past week. I pray that you bless us abundantly, especially during this time. Thank you for all your mercies and please take care of us through this coming week. I pray all this in your mighty name. Amen.